हेलो हेलो, एनीबडी देयर? ओके, एनीवे वी विल स्टार्ट द प्रेजेंटेशन. दिस इज द 21st प्रेजेंटेशन ऑन द CO2 टू केमिकल्स एंड फ्यूल्स. नाउ इन दिस प्रेजेंटेशन, दिस वी आर नियरिंग टू द एंड ऑफ दिस होल कोर्स. इन दिस प्रेजेंटेशन वी आर गोइंग टू लुक एट फ्यू वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट एस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ photocatalytic reduction of TiO2. Now, the first thing that we have to realize is TiO2 as a photocatalyst is known probably for centuries together, but in the early report is in the 56 or around 50s, in the 50s. Then in 1968, 69, Fujishima Honda, in their bulletin of the Chemical Society of Japan paper, they have talked about the titanium dioxide used in PEC cell. Then the 1972 Nature paper, they have first time come up to this water decomposition reaction. Now, from that day onwards, if you look at the number of papers on TiO2, especially on photo processes, the number of papers were of the order of 50 papers per year. But if you take the decade from 2000 to 2013-14, you'll be surprised you to see that about 10,000 papers per year is appearing. Now, why this is the case is the question that we have to ask ourselves. We will get an answer to this a little later. But the reason why this type of explosion has happened is that the moment you are talking about photocatalytic or photoelectrochemical processes, it is giving rise to various possibilities. That is what we have listed at the bottom. One is the production of chemicals, which we are concentrating for quite some time. Another one is the decontamination of pollutants, especially organic pollutants in water and other things. Then there are other possibilities of fuel production. We will look at the fuel production a little later. But what the fuel production means, that it is capable of giving rise to carbon monoxide, and carbon monoxide can give rise to carbon. Then it can get hydrogenated and give rise to hydrocarbons. This is the one process that we are looking. There are other bacterial and other biochemical processes are also possible. So therefore, what is happened is that the original idea of titanium dioxide for water decomposition has opened up a new and a great avenue for a variety of processes. So now, if we have to look at the number of papers per year, it is now more than 10,000 papers per year. Now, we have to also understand a few other things about the titanium dioxide. Titanium dioxide in the bulk and titanium dioxide in the isolated polyhedron behavior. We are going to look at that in a few minutes. Now, before that, we will say in the case of the titanium dioxide, there are four different varieties of titanium dioxide: brucite, anatase, rutile, and TiO2. Now, out of this, we are only looking at the two isomorphs, only the rutile and anatase. Now, the characteristics of the anatase and the rutile is the refractive index of rutile is little higher than the refractive index of anatase. Okay, that is because of the very obviously the packing density is different. That is one point. Another point is that the band gap that we are interested in is slightly lower for rutile, slightly higher for anatase, 3.2 for anatase and 3.0 for rutile. Okay, so you know, if you look at all these properties, the bulk material appears to be stable. Okay, 3.0 to 3.2 electron volts for the band gap. However, when we take the isolated TiO4 polyhedron, there is some kind of a property change. We are going to look at few of these opportunities little later. Then we have been repeatedly telling that we must get a uniform activity scale to represent the activities of the titanium dioxide or any other photocatalyst. That we are not yet arrived at a uniform scale, but it is time for us to start thinking about it. So now all these varieties of the situations only are passing, giving us the possibility of looking titanium dioxide. In the next presentation, I will take other oxides. Now, if you take the bulk semiconducting bulk titanium dioxide, that what you are seeing here, it is having, you can see the clearly the valence band and the conduction band and the band gap. Okay, here I have put the wavelength that has to be used. It is, if depending upon whether it is rutile or anatase, it will be depending upon the band gap value of 3 to 3.2 electron volts, the photons have to be put. Now, if I were to take this bulk semiconductor, semiconducting TaO2, to go to a nano clusters of bigger clusters, okay, let us assume hundreds of few hundred moieties or few thousand moieties of TaO2, then the band gap increases. I hope you are able to see here. From 400, it becomes to 350 nanometers. In terms of the wavelength of the light have to be absorbed, so the band gap increases here. Now, when I go from here to a nano clusters of 40-50, it still increases. The band gap is still increasing, comes to 320. When we go to the isolated TiO4, okay, isolated TiO4 is shown here. Then you can see that the band gap has increased and the absorbing wavelength is between 250 to 300 nanometers. Now, what is the problem here? Okay, the problem here is, for example, you take the isolated titanium dioxide, you put the photon, what you are effectively doing is titanium 4 plus becomes titanium 3 plus. Okay, so the electron is removed from that, from the O2 minus, and that is goes to the conduction band. Therefore, the effectively you are assuming that one of the titanium 4 plus sites becomes titanium 3 plus site. This is what is happening is the question. So now this is the isolated titanium 4 plus 2 oxygen polyhedron. Now on this we are absorbing the carbon dioxide. I hope you are able to see carbon dioxide. So therefore the adsorption is taking place through the carbon center and the oxygen center of one of the oxygen centers of carbon dioxide, and therefore the carbon oxygen bond is broken and it releases the carbon monoxide and the oxygen is desorbed. If it is not so, if the adsorbed, if the CO is readsorbed, then it gives rise to CO adsorbed situation here. And it once again gives rise to the scission of the carbon-oxygen bond. Therefore, oxygen is getting dissolved and carbon is present on the surface. And here, this is an isolated site. Now, once we have that carbon surface, I can put hydrogen to that and produce methanol, methane, water, and oxygen. Now, the same isolated TiO4 polyhedron, if I were to put a photon and water, in the same way, water is getting adsorbed. I hope you are able to see water is getting adsorbed like a carbon dioxide. So therefore, it breaks the OH bond. The adsorption takes place. This is the logic we have also already used, that the bond angle has to be changing, but we will not talk about it at this point of time. So the OH bond is broken. Therefore, the surface OH group is present and hydrogen is getting desorbed. This surface OH group is now providing the hydrogen to the carbon surface, which gives rise to the various hydrocarbons. So this is the type of mechanism that has been proposed for that. Now, how do you know that this is all happening is the question. So now let us quickly look at the results. Okay, here I have shown the methane formation and methanol formation from the carbon dioxide and water by putting photons on TiO2. So if you put it on bulk TiO2, you are seeing methane formation, but very small amount. So many micromoles were, it is less than 1 micromole, 0.2 micromole is formed. But if I were to take the titanium dioxide impregnated on Y zeolite, you can see that the methane formation is increasing. The same titanium dioxide Y zeolite, but 1 weight percent of TiO2. Here it is 10 weight percent because of it is some kind of a cluster situation, therefore the yield is low. If you take it 1 weight percent, you can see that the already the methane formation goes to 5 micromoles. Now if I were to take it, the titanium dioxide Y zeolite 1 weight percent of a titanium dioxide, but in an ex situ preparation, so that all the titanium dioxide is on the surface, then you can see 7 to 8 micromoles are present. Now, if I were to take this titanium dioxide SU2 prepared titanium dioxide, but let us assume that we have loaded platinum on the titanium dioxide and then loaded it on zeolite. You can see that the now we are getting nearly about 12 to 13 micromoles per gram of the catalyst. And in both the cases, you can see that the methanol formation is considerably higher in the SU2 prepared titanium dioxide and Y zeolite, or palladium platinum loaded titanium dioxide and Y zeolite. So all these things shows that the isolation is capable of carrying out this reaction. Now this can be understood in number of ways. We are showing one of them. We are going to discuss other things also. When I take the isolated TiO2 and put the photon, it is generating titanium 3 plus site. Okay, now this has to revert back to the titanium 4 plus site. So that is what is the shown here, the photocatalytic reduction of CO2 with water on various titanium dioxide photocatalyst, the paper. So it is now shown the luminance spectrum. So you can see the in the vacuum how the luminance spectrum at around 500 nanometers, whereas in the presence of carbon dioxide the luminance spectrum is reduced, and in the presence of water it is still reduced. What it shows is that the reverse reaction is hindered in the presence of carbon dioxide and water. That means the electron that is released is utilized for the reduction of carbon dioxide and the reduction of water. So now this is the situation. You can see that the absorption will be somewhere here around 300 nanometers, whereas the photoluminescence will be around the 500 nanometers. So what it means is, what we have shown here is the radiative decay from the charge transfer excited triplet, that is this triplet is the decay, that it decays to give rise to this original species. This is what we are seeing as the photoluminescence spectrum here. Okay, now the same thing can be looked at two different ways. What we are looking here is, I hope you are able to see, this is Zener spectrum. Okay, near edge absorption X-ray, near edge absorption spectrum. This is the extended X-ray absorption X-axis. Okay, so now what we are seeing, I hope you are able to see, that in the isolated case, these are all from the isolated catalyst system. So if you look at the isolated catalyst system, the near edge absorption shifts to higher energy or lower energy as the case may be. Okay, I hope you are able to see this. So therefore this is another way of looking at the lifetime of these things. So the same thing is shown here in the X-axis. As you know very well, the X-axis gives you the idea about the near neighbor interactions that are present. Here titanium oxygen interaction is present, whereas here in the bulk material titanium oxygen titanium neighborhoods are present. Therefore the fine structure that we are seeing here is clearly shows that there is an isolated species titanium oxygen only and not titanium oxygen titanium, whereas here in the A spectrum it is titanium oxygen titanium is a bulk titanium dioxide. Okay, so the similar measurements are there in the literature. We will not take all of them. So to show this, that the isolated titanium dioxide, if we can prepare them and load them on high surface area materials, then the reactivity may be more. So now reported CO2 photoreduction catalyst reaction conditions are formation rates in water. Okay, with the moisture using TiO2 alone. As we already told, we are only talking about TiO2. In the next presentation, I am planning to talk about other semiconductors. So we can do this reaction in the gas phase or in the liquid phase. So both cases we have shown here. So it can be saturated gas or only gas or whatever it is. So we can see here the titanium dioxide, TiO2, 1 gram. You can see 500 watts. Formaldehyde is the product or methanol is the product. Now, if I go on decreasing the amount, but using the same lamp sources, the products are formaldehyde or carbon monoxide. Now, pure NTS, if I were to take, you can see that the formic acid is formed. Now, NTS TiO2 in the gas phase gives rise to methane. So, what it means is that, okay, we'll take it up a little later. TiO2 P25 in the gas phase gives you methane. P20 TAO2 pellet at high pressures of the saturated gas gives methane, and the non-supports it gives rise to methane. Whereas if it is not something, it is in the liquid phase, it is only giving formaldehyde and formic acid and carbon monoxide. So therefore, all these things have to be very clearly understood. Okay, why this product selectivity is changing if the gas molecule is gas of water. Okay, here we are talking about gas adsorption from water or gas adsorption of the CO2, whereas this is all saturated CO2 in the aqueous medium, okay, liquid medium. So therefore it means that the product selectivity is dependent upon the medium in which we are carrying out this reaction. So this is one thing. Second thing that we have to realize is, here I have shown the titanium dioxide. If you take the titanium dioxide 001 phase or 110 phase, we can very easily see that the 100 phase of TiO2, here we are talking about rutile. The picture is for the rutile, okay. So 100 phase is active for the CO2 photo reduction, whereas 110 phase is poor for CO2 reduction. You may ask me, why are you only worried about 100 and 110? In the case of the anatase and rutile, when you have a crystalline anatase or rutile, they cleave mostly in these two phases. That means they are capable of exposing these two phases predominantly. So therefore, if it is exhibiting 1110 phase, then it is not so good for photo CO2 photo reduction, whereas 100 phase is good for photo catalytic reduction. So here we have shown the same TiO2 catalyst, reported CO2 photo reduction catalyst, reduction conditions and the formation rates in water with moisture using metal loaded highly dispersed modified TiO2, because of the that is what we saw, that the isolated TiO2 gives rise to higher amounts of product selectivity or higher activity ratios. Here you can see, even you are able to get 150 micromoles. So up to now we have been talking about on the bulk TiO2, we were talking, I hope you remember the picture that we showed. It is bulk in TiO2, it is less than 1 micromole, whereas we are now talking about number, okay. I hope you are able to 30 micromoles, 19 micromoles, 150 micromoles, 98 micromoles, 23 micromoles, like that. So therefore, all of them are put, the titanium dioxide is put on multi-walled carbon nanotubes on zeolites, a variety of them, MCM 41 or 48, we have already shown last time, titanium on SBA 15, on metal loaded systems, and then carbon and nitrogen doped with TiO2 on nanotubes, variety of them. So therefore, it is seen that in the isolated TiO2 situation, depending upon whether it is from the gas phase or in the liquid phase or in the saturated condition, the yields can be changed. So this is yet another question that we have to take ourselves in our presentation. That one, the question number one is, why bulk TiO2 and isolated TiO2 behave differently? The second question that we have to take is, why the reactions in the gas phase and why the reactions in the liquid phase, or why the reactions in the gas phase and in the saturated condition, the reactivity and selectivity is different. These two questions you must remember in your mind, then we will be able to look at them. Okay, here I have shown the number of CO2 molecule, the total CO2 that is dissolved in the situation. Therefore, we cannot expect more than 24 micromoles in those cases. Okay, so in these cases, water is higher, therefore that is possible. So now, this is the conventional energy band diagram. Okay, energy band diagram for bulk and nano cadmium selenide. I have shown this is the bulk cadmium selenide and nano selenium side. What we are trying to see here is, I hope you are able to see it, is that size is 2.5 nanometers. So you can see here the conduction band minimum is now shifted to more negative value. Whereas if I were to take bulk cadmium sulfide selenide, the conduction band minimum is more or less similar to the titanium dioxide. So therefore, even if I were to do an excitation in the cadmium selenide, the electron transfer from cadmium selenide to titanium dioxide as per the conventional route may not be taking place. Whereas when I take cadmium selenide in the nano state, it goes to minus 1.3 is the conduction band minimum, so therefore the transfer can take place. Here I have shown this this we have this data we have given number of times. Here I have shown in the terms of the band diagram the redox potentials for the various products that we are considering, formic acid, methanol, methane and carbon monoxide. I hope you are able to see that with respect to the conduction band minimum these redox potentials are in a favorable position. So if I have activated carbon dioxide, then this the subsequent reduction to formic acid, formaldehyde, methanol, methane and carbon monoxide are all possible processes. So this appears to be the same situation. Now here I have shown a variety of semiconductors which we will take up later on. Here I have shown only to show you what will happen if I were to change the nature of the semiconductor. This because we have to raise this question for our later on. One question we have already raised is that why are we having different in selectivity with respect to saturated condition and the gas phase condition or liquid phase condition. Now if I were to take zinc oxide, you can see in the saturated condition formaldehyde and methanol is formed. So what it means here, okay, I hope you are able to bismuth vanadate, you can see ethanol is formed, a coupled product is formed. So therefore it appears that it, depending upon the nature of the semiconductor, once again the product selectivity is also varying. This is another question that we have to keep in mind. We have to ask this question little later once you are knowing about it. Only one projection I am going to talk about, the dye sensitized solar cells, because it is very often talked about it. Therefore we are going to talk about it. We are not going to discuss this dye sensitized solar cells because it is a solar cell for harnessing electrical energy. Since we are talking about chemicals and fuels, this dye sensitized solar cell is not a very effective medium for chemicals and fuels. But still the mechanism appears to be the same. I hope you are able to see. We are having a manganese oxide cathode and a coated titanium dioxide nanoparticle and ruthenium dye coated anode. Then the electron is pumped from the anode to the cathode and the reduction reaction is taking place. This may be generating a potential which can be used for electrolysis of water, which can also be used for photoelectrochemical reduction of the carbon dioxide. But it is once again is the photovoltaic coupled photoelectrochemical cell. It is not a direct photoelectrochemical cell of the reduction of the carbon dioxide. Now there is another possibility that we have not yet talked about it. We will briefly tell this time and take it up for our discussion next time. Now when we take all these things, it is not necessary that we should take only water or carbon dioxide. We can take any hydrocarbon, hydrogenate that. The same way we can take any donor molecule and oxidize the donor molecule. This is a worthwhile field for some hydrogenation reactions for organic synthesis. Now what are the semiconductors that are possible to do this is the question. So what we have to do is we have to now look at this potential and match them. That is what we have to do. So here I have shown the two representative, okay, this is not the correct value. If they were to be like this, then any one of these semiconductors, cadmium sulfide, zinc sulfide or titanium dioxide or titanium dioxide anion or rutile, all of them are capable of carrying out the organic hydrogenation and organic oxidation reactions depending upon if what is their reduction potential, what is their oxidation potential, okay. But it appears that these semiconductors can do this job. Then we have been repeatedly raising the question of the how to express the activity of the catalyst, the measure. Okay, there are varieties of measures. There are two other measures I have forgotten to tell. Therefore, I will repeat it here because we are going to use all of this to evolve a new thing. Okay, when I said for the on the basis of the illumination, we can talk about the efficiency in terms of the absorbed photons or the incident photons, total illumination or only absorbed photons. Okay, for example, I have a lamp which is having is capable of giving radiations of various wavelength. Now it will the number of photons that will be absorbed, only those wavelengths which are going to be corresponding to the band gap of the semiconductor, but the incident photons can be higher. So therefore there is an apparent efficiency and an efficiency based upon the absorbed photons. Now this is another way of measuring this, but once again we have to worry, what if I were to put in photon, how much is absorbed, how much is scattered, even if it is the wavelength is capable of giving rise to excitation or corresponding to the band gap value. So this is another thing that we have to think about it. Now quickly looking at TiO2 alone, okay, we are taking TiO2 alone, TiO2 P25, what will be the C2-C3 ratio is what we are looking here, okay, coupling products, because we are looking at the fuels. Fuel is higher hydrocarbons. So here I have given the data, the amount of products formed in the photocatalytic hydrogenation of this compound, okay, this olefinic compound, the acetylenic compound, of the four types of TiO2 in the presence of water. Since we are talking about hydrogenation reaction here, okay, I hope you are understanding, we are only talking about the hydrogenation reaction. Varieties of hydrogenations are possible, only one of them I am showing here. So you can produce methane, ethane, ethylene, propane, and propylene and propane, all of them can be produced. So in the same way, if I were to take an olefin here with R1 and R2, R1 and R2 can be different substituents here as I given, they can also be hydrogenated. Okay, this is one aspect that we have not talked about. These are all cadmium sulfide semiconductors. When you use photons greater than 400 nanometers in triethanolamine, in methanol, this hydrogenation reaction goes with 70% yield. You can see that because the redox potentials are once again favorable situation. Okay, so therefore these are all versus saturated columnar electrode. So we have to change this to hydrogen electrode, hydrogen value, so it will be favorable for the reduction of the or the hydrogenation of the olefinic compounds. So in the same way, we can also do the hydrogenation of aromatic substrate olefins with the ethanol and TiO2 P25. Once again, you can see there are varieties of the products that are possible, acetaldehyde and saturated compound. You will see that the once again the redox potentials here, it is once again measured by the polarography. So we are not doing the talking about it, but still they are redox potentials are safe. So an example here is since that was not very clear, therefore I am showing another example here. You can see that this is R1 and R2 can be an aromatic substrate here. Then you can have do in triethanolamine, cadmium sulfide, you will be able to get this saturated compound. So you can see that the yields are very high. So therefore it is not necessary that we should only worry about producing some fuel. We can also produce some chemicals of value-added chemicals. Okay, so here it is a products in the platinum loaded. This is not TiO2; it is not CO2, but nitrate. Nitrate can be reduced to nitrite, ammonia, and nitrate. All these things are photocatalytic in aqueous medium, in methanol medium. Okay. So therefore this is one another possibility with which we have not discussed and we are not going to discuss, but just like we are talking about photocatalytic reduction of CO2, it is also possible to do a photocatalytic reduction of nitrates and nitrites to ammonia. Okay, so the photocatalyst that is used here is some kind of a zinc sulfide substituted, nickel substituted for zinc sulfide catalyst. So now here I have shown a variety of acetophenones, substituted acetophenones, and their redox potentials are given. You will be surprised that many, these are all these redox potentials are against saturated hydrogen electrode in acetonitrile medium. So these redox potentials are favorable, therefore these substrates can also be undergoing reduction to give rise to the corresponding alcohol from the ketone. So now finally I want to tell you a very interesting paper. There are about 20 people who are all the leaders in the carbon dioxide reduction on photocatalysis. They met somewhere in the US for some time, and they have come up with a very beautiful write-up. talking about frontiers, opportunities and challenges in biochemical and chemical catalysis of CO2 fixation. This has appeared in the Chemical Reviews 213, 2013. You can see, I hope you are able to see, whomever we have been talking. We have already talked about Bohr-Carsley, we have talked about Robert Morris, we have talked about Raufis, we have talked almost all of them, okay? So they have come up with this thing. So when you have time, you can look at this very important paper that has appeared in the Chemical Reviews recently. Now finally, I'd like to show you one picture, which is what has appeared in April 24th. Today is we are 1st of May, so we are only 6 days before that. There is now a paper in Nature written by this author. There is another set of others which I am not projecting, but what they are talking about is how the copper system is active. I hope you remember that copper system for electrocatalytic reduction, it has a very specific reactivity. Why this copper system is active for carbon dioxide reduction? Okay, here we are not talking about photocatalytic reduction, but we are talking about copper as a catalyst. Okay, this is only to understand. We can extrapolate these ideas to photocatalytic reduction of CO2, but at the moment it is not. It is only electrocatalytic reduction. So you will be able to get the solar panels, generate electricity, and put that electricity on copper electrodes. Then you will be able to produce the CO2 and derive work. Okay, or the CO2 can be put on the fuel cell on the system, and you can put a reduction. So what the essence of this paper is, the electrochemistry that is taking place on copper is not the copper sites, but the boundaries, okay, grain boundaries that are formed is the site for the CO2 reduction. Okay, for the electrocatalytic reduction of CO2, not for the photocatalytic reduction of CO2. What it means is the question. What it means is that I hope you have been remembering that we have already talked about that unless otherwise I have CO2 activation, and the CO2 is, if it is not activated by reducing the bond angle, it will not be able to undergo the reduction. So taking this postulate, if CO2 is going to get absorbed on the boundary site, grain boundary sites, CO2 is getting reduced. So this paper, which is as late as 24th April 2014, this is a paper from the Stanford group of the chemistry department. So they have shown that they have made the same copper catalyst with this size reduction, and they did not see any selectivity of the copper. Whereas when they made the copper catalyst, grain boundaries changes there, then they found the reactivity changes. So therefore, this is the sum and substance of what we wanted to do today. So we will take it up next week on the other two aspects and then come back. Any questions you can ask now? Anybody?